It is with great pleasure that I introduce this morning's special guest speaker to you. Richard Thompson was born and raised in Pennsylvania before starring at James Madison University in Virginia as a member of the baseball team. In the year 2000, he was drafted in the sixth round by the Toronto Blue Jays and started a career that spanned 14 years of professional baseball, eventually led him to the Tampa Bay area with the Rays organization in 2012. After retiring from baseball in 2013, he went back to school to complete his finance degree from the University of South Florida and later earned a master's from the University of Phoenix. Not one to remain idle, in 2014, Rich competed on season 6 of NBC's American Ninja Warrior, where he successfully qualified for the Miami Regionals, placing one spot short of qualifying for the Las Vegas Finals. Currently, Rich is a licensed CPA working for Baldwin Kristen Sherman Partners as an employee benefits advisor. He remains very active in the local community, serving as a board member for St. Lawrence Youth Athletic Programs, as well as coaching youth sports. He and his wife, Teresa, have three children and reside here in the Tampa Bay area. Please give a warm welcome for Mr. Rich Thompson.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. And so he said all the really cool stuff. I'll try to go over it a little bit more in depth. Usually when I'm in this gym, I'm chasing Stevie Darvish around, trying not to let him drop 30 on me. But it's good to be back. I did a convocation last in 2012, so unless you had a rough year in between now and then, you're probably all new people. So I grew up on a farm in Pennsylvania with the dream of becoming a Major League Baseball player like a lot of kids do. And the difference is if you looked at me, it would have seemed like a really big dream. I was 11 years old, probably like 70 pounds. I had three baseballs, and I used a wood bat because I had read in like Sports Illustrated for Kids that scouts wanted to see kids hit with wood. So I got this enormous wooden bat at 11, and my mom would go out to the farm pasture, and she'd pitch balls from like me to these guys away, with no glove, underhand, and I'd whack them as far as I could, sometimes off their shin, and then we'd have to go collect them from around the field. Well, that worked out pretty well, and I ended up going into JV, got the tryout there. We tried out in a gym similar to this because it was freezing cold outside, so we could try out. And the finalists were posted, and I couldn't wait. You know, I was going to finally play JV. We started shortstop, and I was one of two kids to get cut. And the other kid had a broken femur from football season. So my dreams, for some reason, were not shattered at that point. It was just kind of delayed. And my friend's dad called the coach and was like, you know, he's not a bad kid, just let him hang around, you can pick up balls from BP or whatever. And they let me back on the team, and kind of the rest is somewhat history. I had some really encouraging interventions along the way in high school. I had a guidance counselor and an algebra teacher who told me that nobody from my town was going to get a Division I scholarship, particularly a guy to play baseball. And the guidance counselor, who was 70 years old, said that he hit 450 in high school and he didn't get a Division I scholarship, so I should really reevaluate my options. Where it really opened up for me was I went to two camps. I went to the James Madison baseball camp and I went to Princeton's baseball camp. And I was still a pretty bad baseball player at that time, but I was really fast. So one of the things they do in the camp is they line everybody up and have you on a 60-yard dash. And so I ran a 6.5, 6.3. And now all of a sudden I was like, you guys wanna come here? You wanna come here? And I was like, yes. So I ended up going to James Madison and I got my 60 time down to a 6.3 by the time I was turning pro, which I guess football-wise it's a little bit more familiar, it's like a 4.2. And that was a pretty big deal. And it really let me go for as long as I did in baseball because it took me a while to become a decent hitter, a decent fielder, and all those other things that round you out. So, as Nick said, I was a six-round draft pick. I made it to the big leagues fairly quickly. It was my third season, and I was Rule 5 by the Kansas City Royals. It was spring training, expected to make the team. Should have been really exciting. Instead, it was probably the most miserable 45 days of my life. I had a huge sun blister on my leg. I was dropping fly balls. I fell under my glove. I don't know what they were thinking to let me on the team, but apparently they figured I was fast enough that they could, you know, kind of tailor around my weaknesses and use my strengths. Well, I got to the big leagues, and I'm sitting on this top row of the dugout on one of the team, opening day. And opening day is a big deal. Guys play in the big leagues for, you know, they can get a few years in before making an opening day roster. And he said, this is what it's all about. He's like, you made it. And I thought, you know, in baseball, that's cool. This is what it's all about. But I really hope this isn't all it's about because, you know, I'm 24. I hope that my life can improve from here. And it did, and luckily it did, because 3 weeks later I was sent down to AAA with the expectation of coming back soon. That didn't go according to plan. I was down for another 8.5 years. Between that time, I had 3 kids. I played for like 7 different teams. Like I produced by the Red Sox, I had a AAA All-Star team. I finished a master's degree in accounting and passed the CPA exam, and still not getting back to the big leagues. But my perspective changed a lot. I went from every time getting on the field thinking that it depended on the rest of my career, getting my 10 years in the big leagues and whatever else that might bring, to really enjoying the journey and enjoying where I was. I got a call from Ryan Sandberg in May of 2012. Ryan Sandberg, the Hall of Fame Cubs manager, like I had a picture or poster of him on my wall, and he was my manager for 2 years. It was awesome. And getting calls from the manager for me were not good. It was getting sent down from the big leagues, it was getting sent from AAA to AA, it was getting put on the phantom disabled list. So here I am answering the phone call thinking, what is it now? And I got traded to the Tampa Bay Rays. Super excited. Durham's a great place to be. And he said, and you're going straight to the big leagues. So pretty cool. I had been living here for a couple years, got to the big leagues, it was pouring with rain, so I was really happy to head to Dome. And a lot had changed. I was not looking to, I wasn't going to make millions of dollars anymore playing in the major leagues. It wasn't going to be my last job. And so I got to go into it with the perspective of really enjoying the time and just taking advantage of the experience. And that really meant a lot to me. I signed back with the Rays the next year. And in 2013, I made a play up against the wall in Indianapolis and my foot stuck. And it was basically like ringing on the towel. So just twisted. I broke all 4 bones across my foot. I guess there's one more, but that was okay. Broke 4 bones across my foot and tore my Lisfranc ligament, and that was the end. So I had a little knee scooter, got back to Tampa, had surgery, and started going on interviews for my accounting career and took a job with KPMG. Worked out great. Still missed that competitive spirit. Thought I might have a good, interesting story for American Ninja Warrior, and submitted a video with like all the gory pictures and my foot filleted open as they're, you know, putting screws in there and everything. And it was enough to get me on TV. So I got down there, I had the whole like day with Rich Thompson and the film crew, and it was really cool. My kids enjoyed it. And it was just a fun way to stay competitive again. So that's like my Wikipedia life. Everything that you can find about me if you just Google me. But what really, I guess, has inspired me along the way and motivated me is a gift my parents gave me. And that was just the foundation of faith. I grew up going to church every Sunday, into high school every Sunday, into college every Sunday, and even no matter where I was on the road, always went to Mass as I played professional baseball. My parents got divorced when I was 16, and it was around this time that I decided, you know, maybe I should make this a little more personal. And I had a nice big thick Bible next to my bed that was probably fairly unopened. And I decided I was going to start working my way through it. And I started reading a chapter a day, every day, continued it for over 10 years, and ended up obviously going through it multiple times. But it just gave me a centering point. It gave me peace. Like, everybody is told that you will get from it, but not everybody tries. It is also a good thing, I think, at the high school level. There's a lot of stress and hardships that you endure, and it really helped me get through that. So one verse that I think a lot of athletes write on their hat or put on a sign, Philippians 4:13. You guys familiar with that? You guys know it? Is anybody going to yell it out? Anybody? Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. And that's great. It's great motivation. It's knowing that you're going to get to the big leagues. Like, you can go up against Mariano Rivera. Side note, I hit a homer off him and won a bat. And it's like the luckiest thing that ever happened to me. So he will never remember it, but it's probably one of my highlights. What's really interesting is before Philippians 4:13 is Philippians 11:12. It says, I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry. Content is not complacency. It's just being grateful for the situation you're at. And that's something that I think I got later in my career, and I didn't have earlier. I would desperately try to achieve each and every goal as if it was the only thing that mattered. But the problem with high expectations and the desire is that with goals, you work so hard, you reach it, and when you're really competitive, that's it. It's just a moment in time and it's on to the next one. So I've been proud to accomplish some of the goals, like making it to the big leagues, getting my CPA, being an American Ninja Warrior, but ultimately, for me, they're just milestones along a greater journey. And if there's one thing that I hope for all of you, it's that you can enjoy the journey as you're reaching these goals, and not expecting that each one of them is going to bring the fulfillment, or it's just going to be an end point. Number two, in the 7 Habits for Highly Successful People, which is an old book that I actually haven't read, but it says to begin with the end in mind. And that's relevant in goal setting, and it's relevant in what your expectations are. Because I don't have an end in mind. I didn't think that getting to the big leagues was going to be the culmination of my life and everything else is perfect after that. And I think the same thing is true for whether you're a lawyer or whether you make it to medical school. If you think that finishing that degree or getting that accomplishment is the end all be all, I don't think you're going to be as happy as you could be. So what is the ultimate end goal? How about to get to heaven is here, well done, my good and faithful servant. And how do we do that? I think your motto says it all. It says, do all things for the glory of God. Galatians 6:9 says, let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. So my challenge for you is to listen to God's call in your life. For me, it started with that reading a chapter a day and just making myself available. Catechism 30 says, man may forget God, but God never stops calling man to himself. So I encourage you just to be open to that call. Hear what it is. It will bring you peace, it will bring you happiness, and it will bring you fulfillment. After all, if you're to be men for others, you're going to have to be men for God first to truly live that mission. Going to Jesuit will benefit you all greatly. It's amazing. I looked at LinkedIn, things like that. People still put where they go to high school. That's kind of crazy. They'll put it over top of where they went to college. It's just such a great place to be formed and to develop. And so my question to you is the response to Luke 12:48, for everyone who much is given, much is expected. So you will benefit from your time at Jesuit. How will others benefit from you going to Jesuit? Thank you.